Good morning, everybody. Thank you for being patient with us for a few minutes while we got a few things resolved and waited for a few people extra to hop on the line. Thank you for being with us here today. We are presenting our weekly Noesis webinar. This week we are talking about ways to double your project approval rate with these 5 easy fixes. So really briefly, I'm going to introduce myself and my co-presenter today, Jason Putnam, and then we're going to go over the agenda. So my name is Taina Price, and I am a senior manager here at Noesis. I work in the marketing department. Little known fact, based on the fact that I'm in the marketing department here, is that I came from many years working in energy efficiency. Primarily, I worked with utility demand-side management and energy efficiency programs, mostly in the Northeast. I hail from New York. However, in that role, I spent a lot of time working with all the different stakeholders within the world of energy efficiency project sales and development. So that's everybody from auditors and engineers all the way to building owners and policymakers. And so I am going to be emceeing this webinar today. I will introduce my awesome co-presenter in a second, but just keep in mind that as we kind of walk through the slides, I'm kind of playing the role or playing the hat or wearing the hat of somebody who is kind of taking the 10 years of experience in the field and kind of distilling what my lessons learned were from my time working in energy efficiency. So I am very excited to be joined today by Jason Putnam. Hi, Jason.
Good morning.
Good morning. Who is the VP of Sales here at Noesis. And Jason, would you just take a few seconds to talk to the folks on the line about what you do here and what your team does?
Yeah, so our team deals with all of our partners. So we have 180 partners as well as their end customers. So when it comes time to talk about the economic impacts and the financing and being that third party, it's my team that deals with our partners and deals with their end customers in presenting that economic analysis to the financial stakeholders.
Awesome, thank you. All right, so let's go over our agenda briefly. First, Jason's going to give us just a little bit of a Noesis overview. He travels all around the United States meeting with our 180 partners and really works to get a feel for what's happening industry-wide. And so he's going to walk us through a few slides just about what's happening in the market today. And then we're going to jump into the meat of our presentation, which is our 5 easy fixes to double your project approval rate. And then near the end of the hour, we're going to talk a little bit about what we're doing here at Noesis and what we do to help our partners overcome some of the biggest hurdles to project adoption. At the end of the hour, we're going to open it up to Q&A. Oops, sorry, I jumped the gun. We're going to open it up to Q&A. So if you have questions along the way, please ask them. No question is insignificant or small enough. We want to hear from you. The benefit that you get from these webinars, at least in a way of being dynamic, is being able to hear what other people on the line are thinking. And what we do is reserve about 5 to 10 minutes at the end to kind of go through the questions that come up on the line. And it's always interesting to hear from you guys, so please jot down your questions as you have them. So, Jason, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, so I'm going to hand it off to Jason, who's going to talk a little bit about an overview of what's happening here at Noesis and in the market.
I'm going to talk fast because based on traveling all over the country, I have a flight to catch right after this. So we'll do this fast. So on the left, just a high-level overview about us. So we're in business, and for those of you who have been on webinars over the past 4.5 years, we've kind of gone through this maturation process of being a software company, being a finance company, really where we've settled and where most of the success is coming with our partners, our 180 partners, is we are a financial technology company, but our main goal is to help our partners win more deals, so get a higher batting average and win them faster. We have about 180 partners, as we talked about. Where you're going to see here on the slide is there are some that are very big, i.e. Honeywell and Trane. There's some that are mid-sized, some that are specific to lighting, HVAC controls, solar, et cetera. But really the commonality here is we help these partners with every single project. There's no project too big or too small or too insignificant or too massive for us to really help them get involved and move those projects forward with clear next steps. Last year, we finished with about $300 million in energy proposals, which is by far the biggest in the industry. And this year, we are tracking to do $1.1 billion in proposals through those 180 partners, which is also growing. So that's a little bit of a background on us.
Okay, so let's quickly jump into our 5 easy fixes for doubling your approval rate. So just as a reminder, as we go through these slides, I'm going to kind of play the, not play the role, I'm going to kind of give you a little bit of an insight as to kind of the mistake that we've identified and where I kind of saw it in my time in the field, and give you some examples. What I want to just preface is that when we say easy fixes, we're not necessarily meaning that anyone is making any kind of crucial mistake. A lot of the things that we've seen that could potentially be done better and that people are sort of course correcting or adjusting are just parts of doing the business. It's stuff that happens organically, and it's part of the culture of selling energy efficiency. And we're just seeing that there are ways to potentially tighten or refine the way that certain things happen, and that they have been helping our partners along the way sell more projects.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting point. I think of it as I think of most things in sports or baseball terms. But it's not, you know, nobody's batting zero. So what we're trying to do is say we've seen some things that are somewhat systemic in the space, but could really help if we have a hitting coach really groove that swing to up the batting average. I think that's the best way to look at it. And our perspective is one at a very high level, because we see so many projects every day, and you know, my team specifically is on 20 or 30 of these meetings a week where we're dealing with our partners and their end customers. So we just see these mistakes kind of bubble up, probably at a much higher level than other people do, who are, you know, pitching one or two projects a week.
Awesome. Thank you, Jason.
So I think this is a great slide just to level set. You know, our whole business model, again, is helping our partners win more projects and win them faster. So we have 180 companies. Obviously, we can't put 180 quotes up here, but we try to take some quotes just from different verticals and different company size to put them up here from our partners, and how it's manifesting in us really upping that batting average and helping them get clear answers and get answers on their projects much faster with clear next steps.
Awesome. Thanks, Jason. Okay, so jumping into mistake number one, presenting to the wrong person. Basically, we're saying that you shouldn't necessarily be wasting your time pitching a project who doesn't have the authority to approve it. That's sort of easy to say, but I'll try to kind of set the stage and explain kind of some of the scenarios where this could come up. When you've got an energy auditor or an engineer or somebody who manages facilities, they're typically talking sort of at the building level to somebody who is in a similar role. And oftentimes, although that person has operational sort of purview in terms of the types of things that they manage over maintenance of the building, they don't necessarily have the authority to approve large energy efficiency investments or energy-related investments as they come down the pike. And so even though at some level that's the person that most of us have those relationships with in the facility or at the building level, they're not necessarily the person that can kind of bubble up an opportunity that is not something that's a day-to-day expense. And so instead of spending a lot of time taking a great opportunity that's probably something that doesn't have anything to do with replacing equipment at the end of useful life or the typical kind of maintenance contracts that would be in place, what we really suggest here is thinking about how to leverage that relationship in order to find the person that can make those decisions. And so instead of spending time kind of in the ideation phase with that person at the facility level, kind of talking about all of these different ideas, because potentially there can be many, there's lots of different ways to incorporate new efficiency products into a facility. And there may be lots of ways you can see that the building could be saving money. But every time you kind of lob one of those ideas over the fence to somebody who can't make that decision, it's kind of wasted breath. I don't know if you have anything to add on that mistake, Jason.
Yeah, I do. And we see it a lot in the field. And we do a lot of training, and like you said, a lot of traveling. And I think it's pretty prevalent in the mechanical world, so the HVAC control world, where there have been these long relationships, really for decades. There's these service agreements. And, you know, as things break or small things need to be done at a building level, it's always been that facility person or, you know, an on-site engineer who has made those decisions. So it's been a good relationship. But a lot of the stats that I have read and frankly, a lot of our bigger partners have done in the field is that if it's a decision above $10,000, 85% of the time it requires a vice president level or higher to make that decision. So what we see in the field is a lot of these small maintenance type agreements or contracts that happen, but when it comes to something bigger, that person who's in the boiler room can't make that decision, even though they might think they can make the decision or want to make that decision, but ultimately they're not the one who's making the critical business decisions that are financially based decisions for the business. And again, 85% of those decisions, at least right now what's happening in the industry, I think that's changed over the past decade, but 85% require vice president level or higher, and chances are that vice president is not a mechanical engineer. They don't know the pieces and parts of the technology.
I think it's also just important to note that there's a difference between pitching a project at the point where a piece of equipment is at the end of its useful life, because there is a lot more exigence in that scenario. And sometimes you can get a facility person to approve, you know, a boiler replacement for something that is about to die if it means that you're going to have to put in temporary heat and gas or something. And on the flip side, if you're trying to upgrade a boiler, let's say, if we keep the same scenario going, you're trying to replace a boiler that probably has 5 to 10 years left on it, but potentially could be, you know, bringing in a lot of money in terms of energy savings on the utility bill. That's something that that person in that moment, because there is not an emergency situation, can't necessarily sort of push it through the chain of command because there's no emergency kind of fire behind it.
Yeah, I agree. And they have, you know, a facility person just has a different motivation to change out equipment or get something that's more energy efficient than a financial decision maker, let's say.
Awesome. Okay, so I think that we have sort of qualified what the mistake is. Jason, do you want to talk a little bit about what we think the fix is?
Yeah, it's, it's pretty apparent, right? Although I think in execution it's harder, right? Because it goes against the grain of what has happened in the industry for so long. I think it's based on that, you know, those stats that 85% require a vice president level or higher. There's really two different ways to go about it. You have to get, we've done a lot of webinars on the second yes, right? The second yes is that vice president, the building owner, the business owner, a CFO, whoever you want to call that archetype. But your person almost all the time can't say yes. They can always say no. We have a lot of, you know, catchphrases up here that your contact can't say yes, or don't take no from somebody who can't say yes. We just have to understand that it ultimately has to go to that financial decision maker. And, you know, a lot of the webinars we've done is, how do we find that financial decision maker? What do I do when I find that decision maker? What if my facility person or my main advocate won't take me to that financial decision maker? But it's critical, and there's a couple different ways to go about it. One is, you have to find the person. You also, as we charge ahead here with some of these mistakes, you have to be able to speak their language, and you have to be able to do it in a cadence and a manner that's going to resonate with them. So just understand that we hear this a lot, that our partners can't have that financial conversation. Frankly, that's why they, you know, that's why we're there. But more importantly, the facility person or your advocate that you're dealing with is probably even less qualified to have that financial conversation with their boss, or probably even more reluctant to go to their boss because they can't have that conversation. And it's really our job and your job as their customer to make them look like a hero, and to be able to say, yes, technically you should change this piece of equipment or do something that's more energy efficient, but also there's a financial impact of that, and let, you know, me as a partner and Noesis as a company put that case together for your financial decision maker and go in there and get them involved as early on in the process as possible.
Awesome. So I'm going to ask a question that potentially many people on the line are thinking. We get this on most calls where we talk about finding the financial decision maker. Do you want to elaborate just a little bit on how you get to that person?
Yeah.
I know that we have, sorry to interrupt you, I know that we have over time dealt with this issue specifically because people feel a little bit weird about maybe stepping around their relationship at the facility level.
It happens a lot. I mean, kind of real life stories. You know, we've got one of our partners has been working on a project for 4 years, and they're still not above the plant level person yet, right? So the first thing is, you kind of have to find that person. Like, literally, who is the CFO of ABC company, or who is the financial decision maker of ABC company? We did a webinar a couple weeks ago. It's recorded. You guys can all listen to it. But it's, you know, as simple as, you know, finding that person is going to Google and doing some research. I have to go to Google anyway and look up what exigence was, one of the words Cyan has used, because I'm not sure what that means. But outside of that, you can go in and look up, you know, just who's the CFO of ABC Hospital, and you can find that person, you can find their email. Now the question is, once you find that, what do you do with it? And there's a couple different ways. One is, if you don't have a relationship at the building level, You can just go to that person. And but understand, when you go to that person, as we talk about some of these other mistakes, you have to go to that person in a different way, with a different message. If you already have a relationship in the building, it's really about going arm in arm with your advocate, letting them know that this piece of technology is not what their boss cares about. As we jump ahead to some of these mistakes, that piece of technology has a positive impact on the business or is mitigating some level of risk that the financial decision maker is going to care about.
Awesome, thank you. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's jump into mistake number two, which is leading with technology. And our chart here is kind of in jest, but decision makers who understand energy, and particularly energy-related projects, it looks like about 1% based on our really in-depth research.
I don't know if it's in jest. I mean, we talk to 30 a week, and I think we've met one, so it's probably less than 1%.
Okay. Well, let's just unpack what leading with technology means. And I'll kind of just sort of step back and sort of acknowledge that within the world of energy efficiency, people who present and propose and build energy-related projects are mostly experts in the field. They're engineers, they're PEs, they're CEMs, and they spend a large majority of their professional career kind of understanding all the different pieces and parts that go into being able to model and develop these projects. And so it seems only likely that leading with the technology, leading with the sort of solution to whatever is causing the, you know, abundance of utility bills or what have you, is kind of the right foot forward. And I think just based on the way that energy audits are developed and presented sort of as a standard across the industry, that's just kind of the status quo and the way that things have always been done. And so I think part of what we're going to talk about today a little bit is figuring out kind of who you're speaking to and why leading with technology, even though it is the crux, it's the whole point of the work, might not necessarily be the best way to start a conversation with somebody about an opportunity. Jason, do you have anything to add there?
I think it's very accurate. And the interesting thing with these mistakes is, you know, we said mistake one was, you know, not involving essentially a decision maker. You can solve mistake two, three, four, and five, but if you don't solve mistake one, all these become irrelevant, right? So they're intentionally in the order by which they need to be solved, right? So mistake one was you have to involve a decision maker. So mistake two being, now that you've involved that decision maker, you have to understand that they don't care about your lights, meaning they don't, because they don't understand what KWH stands for, they don't have a mechanical degree. Frankly, it's not something they understand, so they don't care. What they do care about is what this thing, whatever it may be, does for their business. So it used to be in this industry, most people who made these decisions were technical-based people. Well, now, because of budgets and everything else, it just tends to be a financial-based person. So that financial-based person can't read a 60-page audit, and even if they could, they're not going to because their attention span is so short. So the days of somebody buying something tangible are really going away. What they're buying is the intangible of what that thing will do for them or for their business. So, for example, people don't want to chain out lights because their lights work. Well, if they realize those lights are going to save them 30% and that saving is going to manifest into cash flow to their bottom line, that is something a financial decision maker or a small business owner cares about. They frankly don't care about the lights. And one of my favorite stories, which we tell on a lot of different webinars, was a conversation I had with a CFO. It was after one of the presentations. It was a project they move forward with. But at the end of the day, his feedback was that he sees a lot of these presentations from, you know, mechanical firms and lighting firms, et cetera, and they're all technical based, and they've got to, you know, go through an hour of this audit, and it's not what, just to get to what he cared about. And his correlating story was telling to me, Jason, I don't care about, he said, when I go home and I turn my thermostat to 72 degrees, I just want my house to be 72 degrees. I don't care how it got to be 72 degrees. I don't care what goes over what coil through what compressor. I don't care if there's dragons breathing fire in my basement. I just want my house to be 72 degrees. And understanding that is critical in moving forward with these projects because, again, when I say they don't care about the technology, they care about it in the standpoint of one technology versus another is going to have a more positive impact on the business, but an ABC chiller versus a DEF chiller is irrelevant to them personally.
Yeah, and I think potentially focusing on those key specification differences could also just obliterate your window to their sort of time that they're listening to you.
Yeah, I mean, it's like you're speaking a completely different language to them. So in their mind, it's almost a waste of a time. And it's nobody in that position is going to admit that they don't understand something. So they're not going to go, hey, wait, I don't know what you're saying. So at the end of the day, they're just sitting through an hour worth of gobbledygook in their mind to get to the punchline at the end. And really, what they need is the punchline up front, the financial impact up front, the economic impact up front. And then if they care about that, they can then go to the rest of it. And frankly, they pay people in a building to care about the technical part, right? So if we can talk to the right person and get their buy-in on why they care about the project, they'll then start allocating resources to make sure the project moves forward. And those people are going to be technical people.
Yeah. Okay, awesome. Let's look at what we suggest as a fix.
So again, it's all about business impact, right? So I've looked at many an audit. I'm sure Tanya's looked at 100 times more audits than I have. They're typically between 40 and 60 pages. And the cadence that people go through that when they're presenting the project or the proposal is, you know, they say, hey, Joe, who's a, you know, CFO, here's how we started. We met, you know, 2 years ago. And then they go through this hour-long story to eventually get to this punchline of the economic impacts, even if they get there. And what we found with a lot of our research, and again, we do 30 of these calls a week with financial decision makers, is if you were to look at a small business or a CFO's handbook, the only thing they care about is cash flow. Like, that is it. Their mantra is conserve cash, make cash, and use that cash to grow my business. So we used to think they really didn't care about an audit, which is true. They didn't care about the technology, which is true. They actually don't even care about payback, right? What they care about is what benefit does my business get, or what risk am I avoiding by doing this project? So what you're going to see here is one of our deliverables, but all it talks about is you should do this thing. This thing is going to generate cash for you. And they don't always have to be cash flow positive. In this example, it was no money down, and oh, by the way, your savings are greater than your payment, so why would you not do this? Because all that green drops to your bottom line. That is the message that a CFO cares about, or a financial decision maker cares about, or a small business owner who owns a gas station cares about. They care about cash to their bottom line, and that's it, right? Although they might have other reasons why they want to do this particular project, you know, be it tenant comfort, or I want new lights in my gym because they make things look better, or whatever those reasons, that's not the most compelling reason for them to do a project. Now, understanding that a facility person or a technical-based person within a building is going to have completely different reasons why they want to do this project. So you have to be able to speak both of those languages. But understand, the facility person can't really give you the real yes. And the person who can give you the real yes is this financial decision maker, and they need this message delivered in under 2 minutes, which is really, really, really critical and very difficult for people, frankly, with an engineering mindset, who are used to kind of building up to a story.
I think I was just thinking about what, in terms of like writing a research paper, if there's a way to kind of equate what we're doing in terms of leading with business impact. And I think if you think about, you know, building science as a science, you kind of have all of these different pieces of checks and balances you have to go through to get to your conclusion. Like, you know, what were the fuel bills and what were they saying and what were the tests you ran and what did they conclude? Basically what we're saying is put the results of your whole study in your abstract. So you get one paragraph kind of at the beginning to say exactly what the point of this is, and then you can dive into all the details you want. People can jump through 100 charts, but kind of equating what might happen in a sort of other scientific practice to the way that we present a business case.
It's why the internet works, frankly. So if you think about that, if I do a search on the internet, it gives me two sentences, and in those two sentences I can determine if I'm going to click on that link and read more. A research paper is the same way. Tell me what the research paper is about in a paragraph. If I'm interested, I will read the rest of the research paper, right? But in this industry, what we see is most people, that overview happens at the end.
Don't save the good stuff.
Yeah, don't save, exactly right. Exactly right.
Awesome. Okay, let's jump into mistake number 3. Going at it alone. This is sort of an eerie image, but when we talk about going at it alone, just understanding that there are a lot of different ways that you can kind of bolster or enhance your credibility in your project and also in the way that you're presenting your proposals, and that you don't have to necessarily be the person who sort of speaks for yourself and stands behind the work all on your own.
Or being, you don't have to be the expert on everything, I think is another good way of looking at this.
That's true. And I think we've been talking a lot recently here about this kind of idea that people who work in energy efficiency particularly have all of these different certifications and a lot of training that they undergo in order to have the right and the privilege to propose these projects, similar to architects and doctors. There's all these different pieces that you need to have in order to be able to consider the health and safety and the ramifications of the projects that you install. But that's true for every facet of people within different careers. And so that's true for salespeople. It's also true for people who work in finance. It's true for people who work in marketing. And once you're kind of in that career and you're working at it, it doesn't mean that you need to know every other piece that is related to selling energy efficiency. You're an energy, you know, sort of science expert. It doesn't mean you need to necessarily know the ins and outs of everything about finance, everything about sales techniques. It just means you need to be able to leverage or work with other entities that have the expertise that you need in order to have that sort of well-rounded package.
That's a great point. So let's take a CFO, for example. A lot of them have, you know, letters after their name and accreditations after their name, but they're an expert on finance, right, and economics and investment. They are not an expert on energy. They're not an expert on sales. Frankly, I can tell you our CFO is not an expert on sales, right? But what they do is they bring in people who are experts on those things, right? So if you think about well-run companies, they're going to bring in a great person in marketing, a great person in sales. If it's within a building, they're going to bring in a great building scientist or a great facility person. And that C-level person or that business owner is going to rely on that person and their expertise, but they don't have to be an expert on everything, just an expert on that particular field that they're an expert in.
Awesome. So let's talk about our fix.
Yeah, it's interesting, right? I think the way you laid it out is right. I think most people by nature want to, if it's something they don't know, but they feel like it's going to help them in their career. So in this example, it's going to help them close projects, more projects, and close them faster. They want to be an expert on it. But like I can tell you, there's a bunch of finance people who work for me. Like they've spent 20 years being finance experts, right? You can't become a finance expert overnight, just like I can't become an engineer overnight. No matter how smart I am or how much I read or what I do, I'm just never going to be able to go in and do an audit a week from now.
Well, and you can't fake it with people that do.
No, you can't fake it, right? It's right. The most critical thing is actually being able to speak that language. So what you're seeing on the right is something we deliver that's called a third-party investment analysis that solves a lot of problems. And whether you do it with us or somebody else, it doesn't matter. But the important thing here is that financial decision maker, again, you have to start with that person, right? You have to be able to speak their language. But when you go into the room, understand that they're somewhat already on defense, right? Because they don't know the technical impacts of this project. All they're hearing is a lot of technical stuff. So now we're talking about the financial impact, but they're also having to take your word for it. So typically, the financial decision maker doesn't have a relationship with your firm. Right? The facility person might, but the financial decision maker doesn't. So now we hear lots of things like, you know, I'm not sure about this particular firm, or I'm not sure these numbers are real, or they might not manifest for me. So it's really important to have kind of two things addressed when we talk about going at it alone. Number one, somebody who's going to speak on your behalf, right? You're a we make all of our partners go through some qualification process. You're a trusted partner. We've done projects with this partner before. We've worked on projects with this partner. So that's a role we play in this particular example where we're validating the partner, which makes the financial decision maker and other people in the room feel much better. In addition, it's vetting of the numbers. Because if you think about the typical dynamic, your project, and you know your numbers are real, but they're your numbers. A financial decision maker is almost having to take your word for it. And because they can't unpack the engineering work, because they're not engineers, it is literally a leap of faith for them. So what we found is the biggest catalyst for us and for our partners is us playing that third-party role where we're validating the partner, but more importantly, we're validating the number. So all of those, you know, $30 million a week worth of projects that come in, before we help present them with our partner side by side, we validate them, we vet them. We have a whole team of engineers here and a whole data set of projects by which we'll take that particular project and bump it up against other project types, similar technology, similar building types, you know, et cetera. So when we actually present to the financial decision maker who has a two-minute attention span, we're able to mitigate all their concerns. Mr. or Mrs. CFO, you should trust the developer. You should trust the numbers. Here's why. Because we've done all this research on it, and they're things that they care about. They're the economics. They're the business impact. They're overcoming budget and trust. And that's what this step really does is the two biggest reasons projects don't move forward is lack of budget, people don't budget for this, and lack of trust. And this really helps with both of those.
And just to be clear, this process is not meant to usurp any piece of the process that happens on the engineering side.
No.
Right? So people still work with their clients to design projects. They still go out and do data collection in the field. They still run all their analysis and model the building. That's a piece that we can't necessarily, well, and we don't want to. You're experts in that. It's a piece that we don't sort of have any stake in. What we do is have kind of a second set of eyes with our in-house energy efficiency experts just for peace of mind to make sure that all the incentives line up, that all the different specifications that are necessary in order to meet a criteria or another line up. And, you know, we don't often catch big things. Sometimes we catch little things. And sometimes it's just reassurance that it is an awesome project and that those savings are really killer. And then on the flip side, being able to really take that emphasis and translate it into what the business and financial impacts are of the project.
The interesting thing is, you know, early on as a company, we did a lot of this work as we do it today, and a lot of it we handed to our partners and said, go talk about it, right? And what we found is they weren't comfortable having this conversation, and also it was still them having the conversation. So the end customer, the financial decision maker, still had to just essentially take their word for it. So really where a lot of our growth has come in the past year is us being that third party who's going to speak on behalf of the developer, which is true, we make them go through a qualification process, but also on the project in and of itself. If we look at a project and we see blatant mistakes or things that are just aren't true, we actually won't put one of these together and won't present it because it's just not accurate.
Yeah. Okay. All right, let's keep moving. So mistake number four is not giving a way to pay. And so if you look here on the chart on the left, we're showing that basically only 10% of projects that are proposed based on our 3 years running our energy project survey, only 10% of projects actually include a way to buy or financing offerings. And I can just sort of say anecdotally that at least in my time in the field, and obviously things are shifting rapidly in the last several years since I've been at Noesis, in particular because people are really looking for ways to offset the cost of taking on energy efficiency. But let's say, you know, 5 to 8 years ago, I was in meetings and watching people propose all kinds of different work, from utility programs to federal programs to straight, you know, market rate upgrades within large facilities in New York. And it's very common to present to a boardroom full of people and not talk about what the options are for paying. And basically, as far as I'm sort of concerned in my previous life, the idea really was that the onus lies on the building owner. They've requested the audit, they've requested the technical study, and so as an engineering firm, you kind of go out and you do that. You're consultative, you figure out what the best course of action is, and you may even know what contractors you would ask to bid on a project, but you don't necessarily say, okay, let's talk about how you're going to finance this. The idea is that there's cash reserves, or you know, it's sort of the idea that the person has come onto the lot with the $30,000 or $40,000 that they need to purchase the car, which is obviously, if you look at that analogy, it's pretty asinine. So, yeah, it's just something that I think for a very long time within the industry, we just sort of took for granted. And I saw tons of projects. I mean, more than two-thirds of the projects that we saw proposed just fizzled over time because there wasn't a way for the building owner to purchase it. And they start looking into internal funds. They start figuring out what they can shift around. They can't come up with the amount that they want. And since it's not something that is broken, it's not, you know, it's not blowing up the boiler room, there isn't any reason to sort of take on Herculean feats in order to pay for the project.
I think you're 100% right, and I see, you know, as the industry has changed over the past 5 or 10 years, there's kind of two reasons, using your example, Taina, that things have kind of changed, and we need to change with them. Number one, you know, 5 or 10 years ago, there were budgets and funds really at the facility level, so it was at the discretion of a facility person to spend some of that cash. So it was budgeted and all that. That has really changed, right? As people have pulled back and pulled budgets more at a corporate level and then allocated out, there's just not as many funds available for a typical facility person or a building level to be able to just allocate those funds for a particular project. The other thing that we see is, you know, a lot of the assumptions that our partners make or people on this webinar is, well, they'll find the money, right?
If they want it enough.
If they want it enough, they'll find the money. A lot of people don't want this enough, right? They have to be sold on the project first, so financing's really after the fact. But the other side is, if, let's assume they can go out and find the money, right? They don't have it on hand, but they can go to their bank and find the money. That timeline to get those types of funds is very long, right? Typically, it takes 90 days for a business to get approved, even if they have a line of credit. They're putting money down. They're doing all this stuff. So if you think about it that way, what else could happen within that business between the time they want to do your project and the time that they can actually go get the money, right, get the funds? Well, something broke. Somebody got fired. Somebody needs to get hired. You know, the roof fell apart. So there's, we always use this terminology that time kills all deals. So it's not just about having financing. And again, 90% don't offer a way to pay is incredible. But more importantly, even if you think the customer can go out and get their funds, and they can, what could happen within 4 months where they're just going to put that project on the back burner, which happens a lot because there's something else that happens?
Well, and I mean, this is something that we experience with some really large projects. There was a particular project in New York that I was involved in that had solar, PV, and cogeneration, and it was like a $3.5 million project. And the company did have funds internally to pay for the project, but there were these two factions, you know, the sustainability and engineering faction that knew that there was the money and wanted to spend it that way, and then there were, you know, other organizations within the company that were kind of using their power to veto that because there were other opportunities, whether they're, you know, luxury enhancements to the facility or, you know, investment in new staff, staff training. I mean, so you can also get into a war where time kills all deals in a couple of ways, not just whether a person has agreed to buy the project. They could be totally interested and they could have money in reserves to pay for it, but figuring out internally through the corporate structure how to get everybody on the same page to approve an expenditure of, I mean, most of them are of considerable size. I mean, $250,000 and upwards are pretty significant investments when you think about the kind of capital that is that could be invested in other parts of the business. All right, let's talk about our fix.
So the fix is financing overcomes hurdles, right? And I do a lot of guest speaking, a lot of traveling. We do a lot of webinars. And right now there's people on this webinar going, well, my customers have never asked for financing. And then right now you guys are all nodding to yourself saying, hey, that's right. Let's talk about why that is. So let's take a step out of energy, take a step out of Noesis for a minute, and just think about this industry in general. So capital equipment is a very big industry. Just so you know, commercial leasing, so that is buildings, the same buildings you're walking into the boiler room, those same buildings finance almost everything in the building. Copiers, IT equipment, office furniture, planes, forklifts, cranes, you name it, everything that's in the building. So a little bit of a trivia question. This year, that industry, commercial leasing, capital equipment, was $903 billion. And they said next year, or this year into 2015, it's going to be $1.4 trillion with a T. So let's pause there for a second. So it's $1.4 trillion. So the same buildings you're walking into are spending $1.4 trillion financing things that are considered capital equipment. Energy efficiency is considered capital equipment, right? So this is not stuff they budgeted for, this is stuff they're financing. So why is energy efficient, you know, energy efficiency different than that? Just so you know, of that, you know, over $1 trillion, energy efficiency equipment make up less than 1%. So everyone says, well, my customers never asked for financing. Really, your previous slide sums it up. Everybody who's walking in selling a copier or fleet vehicles or cranes or office equipment, every one of them, 100%, give their customer a way to pay for it that is not write me a check or put it in the budget. They're giving them financial options. This industry is the exact opposite. You just showed it. 90% of people offering capital equipment that happen to be energy related don't give them a way to buy. So it's a very easy fix. You have to give them financing options just like everybody else is. And what we find is that when you give them a way to pay for it, and they realize that this is capital equipment and they can finance it, it's just a more comfortable conversation. And the big difference with this that I think everybody realizes is a copier doesn't generate cash flow. You know, fleet vehicles don't generate cash flow. This equipment, because of the savings, almost all the time, has some positive impact on the business. So not only is it you can finance it, but it's going to have positive impacts, which is very different than other things they do. So for a CFO or a business owner who's already, even a small gas station who's leasing or financing their, you know, the refrigeration units within the gas station, this is how they're accustomed to buying things. Everyone we talk to, a huge portion of these financial decision makers, don't realize they can finance this equipment. So just giving them a way to do it is critical.
Yeah, and I think we use a lot of different analogies here, like, you know, going to Rooms to Go or walking onto a car lot. At this point, all the ways that companies and people as consumers also, because remember, the people that we're selling to are both part of the company as an entity, but they're also consumers who finance things in their personal lives. It is almost impossible these days to go anywhere and not have financing offered. And so as an industry, not having sort of a consistent message around being able to offer financing essentially makes the road so much steeper. You're selling a product that potentially, for all intents and purposes, is not necessary in a facility, even if it's a great opportunity. So it's kind of an evangelical sale to start. And then on top of it, you're asking them to agree and then go rearrange their lives and their organizations in order to find the money to pay for it. That just every hurdle just continues to diminish the chance that they're going to be able to say yes and do it in a timely fashion that sort of helps them start seeing the benefits and the cash flow right away.
Yeah, I mean, the copier world is an interesting world, or really any capital equipment that, you know, financing is just commonplace. If three copier salesmen or three forklift salesmen walk into, you know, into a particular building and two of them have financing and one of them doesn't, the guy who doesn't is just not going to get the time of day, right? Because it's just so commonplace. And again, the financial decision makers are used to it. I mean, I had a conversation with a president of a big design build firm, and you know, his feedback was the same thing, right? My customers never asked for financing, and we're a very successful company, and we've been doing this for 30 years. And I had to paint a different picture for him, and I used the same example you used, tying up a car lot, and I said, let's say you're selling 100 cars a month at your dealership that you own. And you don't have financing, right? 100 cars is good. Do you feel like if you offered financing, you would sell more cars? And he said, yes. Do you feel like you would sell more expensive cars to the 100 you already sell? Well, yes. Well, do you feel like if a dealership opened across the street who had financing and you didn't, that you would sell less than 100 cars? To which he said, yes. And that was a bit of the epiphany moment for him, that those people who are out there selling this stuff, who are giving their customers, you know, a way to buy that's you know, commonplace for them, are really having a distinct competitive advantage.
Great. Okay, so let's talk about our fifth mistake, leaving the ball in their court. This is sort of a point of heartburn for me. After having been, let's say, roughly maybe 200 different presentation meetings with large boards that take, you know, months, sometimes years to get together, basically walking away from the conversation without next steps or action items. And so I think that this mistake can kind of manifest itself in two ways, as we were talking about yesterday, Jason. The first is actually not talking about whether they want to invest or buy the project or move forward.
Not asking for the sale.
And then the second part is kind of just walking away with no resolution and no sort of set of next steps. And so, I mean, I can say definitively that I was never once until 2 years ago in a meeting where we said at the end of the meeting, great, do you want to do this? Okay, or I'm going to follow up with you in 5 days' time, and you're going to tell me whether you want to do it, which seems a little bit ridiculous, because when you think about purchasing anything in the consumer world, you know, are you going to buy this house? Are you going to buy this car? Are you going to pull the trigger?
Even in the business world, copy the same things we talked about, right? Copiers,
sure.
And cranes, et cetera.
And, you know, in particular, having a salesperson that you know once you've been sort of pitched. I mean, this has happened to me 100 times with marketing software. You sit through a demo. They ask you if you have any idea when you're going to buy it. You say yes or you don't say yes. They follow up in 3 days. Hey, I'm just following up to see what your timeline is. I mean, we just don't do that. And I, you know, if anyone on the line is saying, Tiny, you're absolutely wrong, that's crazy, I do that, I'm not trying to be offensive. But in my former life, I never pushed that. I never felt like it was something that we needed to do. And we sent out thousands of proposals during the time that I was working with my previous company. It was just kind of like, this is a relationship and we want to nurture it and we don't want to push anybody in the wrong direction. And Jason knows we've had epic debates about, you know, the whether sales is a good or a bad word within energy efficiency. And I think that there's just a little bit more assertiveness that needs to happen in these kinds of deals in order to really be able to you know, grow a business and to acquire new customers.
No, I think you're right. I mean, it's a systemic problem. I tell a lot of stories about this, but it's a lot like, you know, I spent a lot of time as we're building out, you know, our offerings and our services, really being in those meetings and understanding what's going on and understanding the dynamics and the, what we call the closing dynamics in sales. The approval rate's awful in this industry, right? It's under 20%, which means 80% of projects don't move forward. And what we found, funny enough, as we walk through all these mistakes, you have to involve the decision maker. But, you know, at the end, you have to actually ask somebody if they want to do it, right? I think of it a lot like Sadie Hawkins stance in this industry, where you have girls on one side, boys on the other, and everyone just kind of stares at each other. Nobody asks anybody to dance. It's okay if somebody says no. I know you've put a lot of time and effort into this, but again, I use the examples many times that I've been in meetings and at our partners where they have their board that has all the deals they're working on it, and there's deals who've been on that board for 4 years, right? And they're probably the fifth sales rep or the fifth engineer to work on that deal, and they just keep sitting there without anybody ever asking. Funny enough, if you ask somebody, guess what? They'll tell you. And they'll tell you yes or no, why or why not, what needs to happen to move forward. And just, I know this sounds very simple, and there maybe is one or two people on the line who say, no, I do it every time, but it is systemic. Most people don't. You just have to say, are you doing it or not? But the critical thing here is you have to be okay with a no. And a no is an okay thing, because if not, it's just going to sit there for 4 years and nothing's going to happen.
That's right. All right, so let's quickly look at our last fix.
I think this is important, right? If you're dealing with a financial, and we have a couple slides here, if you're dealing with a financial decision maker and you've told them, you know, either what risk they're mitigating or what benefit they have as a company, they have to understand that every day they wait, the problem you're solving gets worse, right? So in this particular example, they're wasting money, which if you flip that into savings and in turn into cash flow, by not doing this project in the next 6 months, they're giving up $15,000 to their bottom line. So depending on the business size, let's assume this was a gym or a car dealership or whoever, how many widgets do they have to make and sell? How many memberships they have to sell to generate that same level of cash flow? It's exorbitant. And that's the message you need to have with a financial decision maker is there's no need to wait. Usually people waited because they didn't have a way to pay for it because people in this industry aren't giving them a way to pay for it. So now what we've said is you're talking to the decision maker, you're speaking their language, you're giving them a way to buy it, and you're telling them, you should do it now, and here's why. So cost of waiting is important, right? And asking for the sale is important. These are some of our stats, obviously, and some case studies that we have here. But, you know, these stats even shock me, and I think it's a little bit of 101 type stuff, but everything you mentioned on the front end of this mistake step is critical. What we found is when we're presenting with our partners, we're speaking to the right person, we're making the economic case, we're letting them know why they should do it and why they should do it, you know, now essentially or over the next period of time and what are those clear steps, 71% of the time on the presentation where we're presenting side by side with our partners to their customers, 71% of the time the financial decision maker is asking for a credit application. So that seems just, okay, so what's the big deal? There's no CFO in the world who's going to fill out a credit app just for the heck of it, right? So this is a buying signal. So 71% of the time, they're saying, yes, send me a credit app, which means they're interested in doing the project. And if we looked at the other stat, where typically 80% of the time projects aren't moving forward, this is just a huge shift in the market. And there's some of them who want to do the project but don't want to finance with us, and that's fine. Our main goal is to help our partners win more projects. And even if they're not ready to go right now, we're seeing almost every time there are clear next steps. Yes, but we have to, you know, I have to hand this off to Steve, who's going to look at the engineering work because he's my facility guy, or I need to go look at this, or I need to go do that. And the speed of which these are closing very, very, very quickly.
Awesome. So I think that's what we've got in terms of the mistakes and the fixes. I'm going to let Jason talk for a minute about a few more slides just about what we're up to here at Noesis. But before I do that, I just want to reemphasize that even though we're highlighting these mistakes as things that can be fixed and edited. We understand that they're a part of the business. They're things that take time to fix. In some cases, they're entrenched. And a lot of times, a simple small adjustment, even to one of these steps, as Jason was mentioning, can kind of help all the way through your process deal flow. So by no means are we saying these are egregious things that people just are doing way wrong. It's taken us years of talking to building owners and watching the way that our partners present and understanding the results of the ways that we tweak the process and the way that we help the people that work with us to kind of zero in and hone in on what these mistakes are and kind of what the subtle techniques and subtle tweaks are in order to help kind of course adjust for each of them.
Okay.
All right, so Jason, do you want to talk just for a few minutes about what we're doing here?
Sure, yeah, we'll keep it at a very high level. Again, we're people think of us that we have software, which is true. People think of us that we have financing, which is true. Kind of the one, you know, thing I like to do for my soapbox is we're not a financing company. What we are is a company that helps our partners win more projects. So we know that lack of budget and lack of trust are the two biggest issues. So we have built and spent a lot of time, specifically over the past 18 months, understanding these two issues and how to overcome these two issues. And you saw a lot of those. So our main goal is put financing aside, put software aside, is to be that third party, to have the energy expertise, which we do have, that we've built over the past 4.5 years, as well as the financing expertise that we've built over the past several years. So when we sit down with you and our partners with the financial decision maker, we're able to present this third-party investment analysis that talks about why the project makes sense economically. Forget about financing. That's what we do. Why do you care as a financial decision maker in your language very quickly in 2 minutes why you should care about this project? And if you care about it and it makes sense for you, what are the next steps for this project? Kind of end of paragraph. Then once we know if they're moving forward with the project, and many times they're moving forward with the project and they don't want to use our financing, and we're okay with that. It's really about helping our partners win those projects. But a huge portion, as we talked about, of those want to move forward and they want to finance it. And that's what we're there to do, is help them make the right financing decisions, whether it is paying cash for it, going to their own bank, or using us or another financing entity. We're really there as a consultant for the end customer. So we're there for our partners to help them win the project, but we're there for the end customers to make sure they can make the right decision once the decision is made on moving forward with the project and how to pay for it. So this is what we do. Again, here's some case studies. We'll just stop for a second here. We've already looked at these stats. This is a good time to use the GoToMeeting portal, start plugging in some questions if you have some. We have a couple minutes here at the end where we have some questions coming in. So there you go. We'll spend some time here, and I think Taina will MC our questions.
Yeah, we've got a few. So let's see how many we can get through now. If we don't get to all of them, we will send around a little email with some answers from the experts as we get to them. So we've got a couple. I'm going to try to put these in order that kind of makes sense in terms of what we talked about today. Someone on the line, Jason, wonders at what point they should involve Noesis before or after the audit, which maybe we weren't too clear about.
So the answer is there's no cut and dry answer. It kind of depends. So for a lot of the big mechanical firms we work on, you know, we hear a lot of people say, "Well, I don't have the meeting with the decision maker yet, or I haven't done the audit. We're still, you know, we have some tentative numbers." We do many of these presentations not to the decision maker to start, right? So of the 20 or 30 we do a week, I would say 5 to 7 are with, you know, a high level facility person where we're presenting the financial impact, and almost every time the facility person says, "Oh, thank God." This is what I've been looking for because I can't have this conversation with my boss. So we get their buy-in on the numbers in the presentation. They already have the buy-in on the technology and the technical part of it. And then that person and our partners sets up the meeting with the financial decision maker where we come back in and do the same presentation. So there's no right or wrong time. It's really any time that you feel like the financial decision maker or the facility person is going to care about the economic impact. Most of the time we see the bigger the project, the more of these presentations we have to do in context of that same project, because there's a lot of people involved, and there's been many of these projects that we've won that we've done 4 or 5 presentations for different people and boards and CFOs.
Awesome. Okay, so we have one that's just sort of about the types of projects that we'll work with, and I'll take this one, Jason, and you can kind of piggyback with anything that I've missed. I'm going to group 2 questions together. One is, will you always create a cash flow positive situation or scenario? And 2 is, how about projects less than 50K? Do you finance those? And the answer is, we work with a really broad spectrum of projects, from cash flow positive to cash flow negative to neutral, projects that are replacements, projects that are massive overhauls, comprehensive retrofits. We work with projects from $10K to $5 million. We're kind of just specialized in the space, looking at talking to people about all the different things that are a part of their business, because we want to be partners that can be relied on kind of through all the different components of things that people sell within our organizations that we partner with.
Yeah, it's really, there's no downside. It's every project, every time. There's literally no downside. We've seen, you can go out on our website and read many of our case studies where we have greatly impacted people's closing ratio, and that's what we're here to do.
Awesome. This is something that we've been, actually, someone on the line is reading our minds, because this is something that we've been talking about a significant amount recently. They're talking about how to dissuade clients from going to the cheapest option, and I don't know if you want to say a few things about selling with scenarios.
Yeah, it's there's a lot of good questions coming in, and actually, if you guys can hang out, I think we should answer all of them. So one of them was, how do I keep my customer from picking the cheapest option? So I'm going to speak 100% from experience, really probably in the just in a couple that we've done in the past couple weeks, but there's been many of them. Typically in this industry, people have been afraid to go in with price, right? So if you think about a lot of mechanical firms, what they do is say, they know there's going to be an RFP for a new boiler, a new chiller, and they want to get just what we, you know, as you guys call a re-and-read, same type boiler that was in there before. The financial decision maker is not the one, the facility person is not the one making the final decision, but what our partners want to do is give them the cheapest option, because they know when the facility person on their own, don't go at it alone, takes it in and just puts those three options in, the financial decision maker is going to go, will the cheapest option kind of give us the same level of performance we've had, and they're going to say yes. We do a lot of what we call selling with scenarios, where the more energy efficient option, which is significantly more expensive, actually has better financial impacts. Doesn't have to be cash flow positive, but it has better financial impacts, better lifetime net lifetime savings. It has better facility better money financial impacts on the value of the building. So we do all that, and what we find is almost every time, when the financial decision maker is involved, they pick the more expensive option because it has more economic, positive economic impacts on their business. So one of the questions on there was, and there's really a couple questions, like, I'm going to summarize them, how do we make money? How does Oasis make money? So there's a couple different ways. Our primary revenue stream is we're a finance company, right? We spend a lot of time with technology and relationships where the interest rates and the cost of capital, all that's very comparable to what somebody would do with a copier, a chiller, or a boiler, right? So it's already in their DNA of how they go out. Rarely is interest rate an issue. So, but we do make money because we're a finance company that way. For our 180 partners, they pay a membership every year, and that membership gives them access to our software, which helps them do some things, but primarily all of our services. So us getting involved in helping them close projects, it's a very small amount. Frankly, it's not a profit center for us. It just helps us get people set up. There's also a qualification process, so not everybody gets to become a customer at Oasis. But that covers getting people trained and getting them onboarded. A lot of times, our goal is just to help them close deals. We know that on the back end, a lot of those deals are going to get financed, so we're going to make the lion's share of our money on the back end.
So we just had a bunch of stuff pour in there at the end.
Can we take the boiler question?
Yes, we can. Yes.
So one of the questions was, could you, and my answer is usually yes, if it starts with could you, but could you do 100% financing on 13 new boilers, right? The answer is yes, right? Just like you could do 100% financing on, you know, 25 new fleet vehicles. The answer is yes, right? And it always comes up that way. There's no right or wrong answer. It's all projects, all sizes.
All technologies.
All technologies, and really all credit types, right? Our whole goal is we have a syndicate of lenders as well as our own money that we can address the market. It's a $1.4 trillion market. We would love energy to be 10% of that. That is our goal, right? To go out there and help these people understand that they can wait 5 years to get that millions of dollars ready for those 13 new boilers, or they can just do it right now, and there's a way to do it, where they're literally putting no money out of pocket.
Awesome. Thank you, Jason. So we had a few more come in. We don't want to keep you guys much past we're already past, so we don't want to keep you much more. What we'll do is work with Jason to get answers to the questions that are trickling in now, and we will have folks reach out to you with the answers.
Perfect.
So, Jason, thank you so much. This was a great webinar. It was really fun. I appreciate you being here. If you have any questions or comments, or you have a webinar idea that we haven't addressed, can you just please shoot us a line at marketing@noesis.com? We're nice, we don't bite, and we welcome all suggestions. So we hope